Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the State of the Climate 2022 webinar. For those joining us for the first time, welcome. And for anyone who's joined us for our webinars before, welcome back. Before we begin proceedings, I would like to acknowledge and pay respect to the Kulin Nations, who are the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet. I'd also like to acknowledge and pay respect to the traditional custodians of all the lands that we are gathered on in all states and territories across Australia, and pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. We acknowledge and respect their continuing culture and contribution they make to this country. Today, we'll give you an in-depth look at the State of the Climate Report for 2022 and learn about the long-term changes to Australia's climate. The report is released every 2 years jointly by the CSIRO and the Bureau and draws on the latest climate monitoring, science and projection information to describe changes and long-term trends to Australia's climate. We go to the next screen, please. My name is Jordan and I'll be your moderator today. I'm joined by Sharon, who will be producing today's webinar. Together, we will make the webinar as interactive as possible. But before we start, may I ask for your attention as we cover off some housekeeping items. For first-time webinar attendees, please see some helpful tips. With the current situation as it is in Australia, this webinar will be conducted from our respective home and offices spaces across the country. Please bear this in mind as we may encounter some technical issues during the broadcast. Our broadcast will run for 60 minutes with plenty of time allocated for questions. This webinar is also being recorded and the video will be shared with you via email. For first-time webinar attendees, please see some helpful tips on your screen. Most importantly, please note the chat icon where you can send through any questions or feedback for presenters during the session and we will answer as many as possible during the allocated breaks. It's the speech bubble button labeled chat on the top of your screen. The icon will be underlined so you know when it's on. If you want to test out the chat box now, you can feel free to tell us your name and where you're dialing in from. We'd love to see it. Thank you to everyone who has sent in questions during the registration process. We've used them to help shape the content today. And we'll get through as many of those as you can as well. And finally, I'm delighted to introduce you to our presenters. From the Bureau, we have Blair Trewin, and from the CSIRO, John Clarke. Blair is currently a senior research scientist in the Bureau of Meteorology. His specialist areas are the development of long-range historical data sets for the assessment of climate change and the analysis of extreme events, both current and historical. He was the lead developer of the main long-term Australian temperature data set, or ACORNSAT, and is the leading is leading the World Meteorological Organization's 2011 to 2020 decadal climate assessment. So big hitters here today. John is leads the regional projections team in the CSIRO Climate Science Centre, where he has worked since 2009. John has a passion for ensuring the vital research undertaken by climate science community is used to inform real-world decisions. His current work has strong focus on helping Australians get the most out of climate change projections. We also have Sharon, Katrina and Lynette who will be answering questions in the background. So we really do have the best of the best at the Bureau and from the CSIRO looking after the webinar today. We have a packed hour for you today, including land climate variables like temperature, rainfall and fire weather, oceans, greenhouse gases, carbon budget and finally future climate. But let's not keep you waiting any longer and get straight to Blair. He'll start us off with an overview of the report and then talk about Australia's changing climate. Don't forget, you can get your questions answered today, so make sure you click that little chat button and start sending them in. It's all yours, Blair.
Okay, thanks, Jordan. And I'd like to start by acknowledging the Wurundjeri people as the traditional custodians of the land that I'm presenting from and the traditional custodians of all of those parts of Australia which are covered in the report. Introducing the report, it's a report which is issued every 2 years jointly by CSIRO and the Bureau of Meteorology. Between us, we're Australia's lead climate science agencies. We play an important role in analysing and monitoring the climate and the changes that have been observed, as well as assessing and communicating future changes in climate. And the State of the Climate report is primarily devoted to documenting the changes that have been observed, but we do also cover the future of Australia's climate, and John will cover that in his presentation. For reports issued every 2 years, and this is for seventh in the series, which started in 2010. Australia is already experiencing climate change. That has become increasingly apparent over recent years. Impacts are being felt across many communities and sectors, and we've seen that with some of the extremes that we've had in Australia over recent years. And those impacts are likely to continue into the future. The report itself is based on the peer-reviewed science information, many long-term observational data sets that we draw on here, as well as many papers and research studies which have been published by Australian scientists and elsewhere time. So the areas I'll cover in my part of the presentation are on the screen now, and before I hand over to John, who will cover some other aspects of the climate. So I'll be looking particularly at surface climate variables, and starting off with temperature. So it will come as no great surprise to anyone that Australia's climate has warmed over the last century and a bit. The total warming since consistent national records began around 1910 is 1.47 degrees. The more limited information we have from the pre-1910 period suggests that the warming since the second half of the 19th century is around 1.6 degrees. And that's fairly close to the average for land areas globally. Land does warm faster than ocean, and if you look at global figures, land areas have warmed by about 1.6 degrees since the late 19th century, and ocean areas by a bit under a degree. That difference also exists around Australia, with the oceans around Australia having warmed by just over a degree since the early 1900s. Now, with that increase in average temperatures, we see a strong increase in the occurrence of extreme heat, which I imagine there's probably some people in southern Australia who are wondering where the extreme heat is at the moment. But we've certainly seen a marked increase in it over the last 20 to 30 years. And what you're seeing here is the number of days each year when temperatures averaged over Australia are in the top 1% of records. And you can see that very hot days were pretty rare until about 1960. Then become somewhat more frequent during the second half of the 20th century, but it's since 2000 their frequency has really taken off. In 2019, which of course will be very well remembered for the bushfires in the summer of 2019-20, but was also extremely hot in January 2019 as well, is a real standout for extreme heat. Interestingly, there are some parts of southern Australia particularly where the frequency of frosts has stabilised or even increased a bit in the last couple of decades. And that's largely due to the influence of the drying of the climate in those regions, which we'll come to a little bit later in the presentation. Now, with the increase in temperatures, we've also seen an increase in the frequency of dangerous fire weather over most of the country. The geographical patterns do vary a bit, but most of the parts of the country do show an increase in the frequency of dangerous fire weather days since the 1980s. That shows up particularly in a lengthening of the season in particular bringing forward of the start of the season. And again, that was something that we saw most dramatically in 2019 when we're starting to get significant fires as early as early September. But it shows up in other seasons as well. And although we've just had, we've had a relatively quiet couple of years in the southeast with relatively mild and wet conditions. Other parts of the country have still been experiencing significant fires as in fact we've seen in Western Australia in the next in the last day or two. We've seen a number of changes in rainfall in Australia, but perhaps the most striking is that rainfall in the cooler months of the year has dropped away in recent decades over much of southern Australia. That's been particularly apparent in the southwest of Western Australia, which gets most of its rainfall during the cooler half of the year. That's on the bottom left shows rainfall averaged over southwest Australia. And we can see there a pretty consistent downward trend since the 1960s. And in particular, years wetter than the long-term average have become pretty rare. 2021 was one, but it was the first year for a long time which had been significantly wetter than the average. So there's a real concentration of drier years there. In the southeast, there's been more year-to-year variability, but again, we've seen a predominance of drier than average years since the 1990s, with just the occasional very wet, cool season in the period since. The rainfall trends in the summer in the southern Australia are less distinct. Southwestern Australia gets very little rain in the summer anyway. The southeast does get rain in summer, particularly the further north you get. And rainfall in the summer has been a bit more stable. But the other major change we see is that rainfall during the summer half of the year, which is the wetter time of the year in northern Australia, has increased quite substantially over the last 50 years, particularly in the northwestern quarter of the country. So Northern Territory, northern half of WA into the WA outback have seen quite a marked increase in wet season rainfall. When you average that all of that over the country, you get a picture of not much change, but that national average hides a lot of very important detail. And the decline in cool season rainfall is especially important because in the cooler months, rainfall is more effective in generating runoff. So cool season rainfall is more effective in generating flow into dams and rivers. And it's also the key agricultural season in many of these regions. So that decline has had a particularly significant impact. With the changes in average rainfall are one thing, but as we've seen pretty dramatically this year, heavy rainfall is something that has particularly large impacts through flooding. And the situation for heavy rainfall is quite complex. In general, in many parts of the world, we see a clear increase in heavy rainfall, fundamentally because warmer air is capable of holding more moisture than cooler air is, all other things being equal. But the situation can be complicated somewhat because on the one hand, the amount of moisture the atmosphere can hold is increasing with warming climate. But on the other hand, the frequency with which weather systems favourable to heavy rain can change as well. And those changes can vary quite a lot between regions. We do see in Australia quite clearly that intense rainfall is becoming more frequent, and that's when we're looking at very short-term rainfalls on timescales of minutes to hours. These are the sorts of falls you might get in severe thunderstorms or in more localised systems. The picture is somewhat less clear when we're looking at heavy rainfall on timescales of 1 day through to multiple days. Whilst many parts of the world, particularly in the Northern Hemisphere, do show a clear increase in those sorts of heavy rainfalls over days to multiple days, the picture's a bit less clear in many parts of Australia. Partly that's because Australian rainfall is highly variable by world standards, and what that means is that it's Yeah, that natural variability can hide some quite large changes. So it's, you know, entirely possible that there is a real underlying change, but we just don't have really strong observational evidence of that. Certainly our expectation into the future is that the occurrence of heavy rainfall will increase even in those parts of the country where average rainfall is decreasing. One of the interesting things here is that a single wet year only has a fairly minor impact on the long-term trend. So the State of the Climate Report went to publication before we had the 2022 numbers. So what you see in the report ends in 2021. But what I've done here is I've added, now that we have the cool season numbers in, I've added in 2022 into that plot you saw a couple of slides ago. And you can see that 2022 is it was a very wet year for southeastern Australia in cool season. Not quite as wet as 2016, but certainly up there as one of the wettest such seasons of the last 50 years. But it has only a fairly modest impact on the changes. So in the report, we say that cool season rainfall since 2000 in southeastern Australia was 10% below the 20th century average. When you add 2022 in, that just changes to 9%. So it has only a fairly minor impact on the longer term trends. In addition to this, there's a number of other changes in the climate system, which I won't go into in great detail here, but there's much more information about them in the report, which you can read. With the decrease in rainfall, particularly in the cool season in the southern half of Australia, we do see declining trends in stream flow at the majority of reference stations. Again, there are local variations, and there are some areas, particularly northwestern Australia, which have seen increases. But much of the much of the southern part of the country has shown decreases. Tropical cyclones are an interesting one. In the Australian region, we have actually seen a decrease in the number of tropical cyclones observed over the last 40 years. And for those parts of the country where we have good longer term records from that, particularly the Queensland coast, we can see that, we've seen a decrease over the last 100 years as well. That's largely shown up as not getting really big seasons in La Nina years, like the last couple and 2010-11. In those years, cyclone numbers have been fairly close to the long-term average, whereas in some past La Ninas, we've had extremely active tropical cyclone seasons. And whilst we don't have clear trends in tropical cyclone intensity in the Australian region, at the global scale, there is reasonably good evidence that the proportion of tropical cyclones that reach category 4 or 5 has increased. So fewer cyclones, but potentially higher intensity and more rainfall with those cyclones. And finally, when we look at snowfall, snow has declined in Australia's alpine regions since the late 1950s. Is the case where you're looking as an indicator at things like snow, maximum snow depth, the length of time with snow cover, or the number of snow days. Those changes are most prominent at lower elevations and also at the start and end of the seasons. The middle of the season at high elevations hasn't changed so much, but in general, we do see a decline in snow over Australia over that time as the climate's warmed. And with that, I think we're open to our first round of questions.
Yes, we are. Thank you very much for starting us off today, Blair. We're going to talk to John soon about oceans and seas. But first, we'd love to get to some of your questions. Remember, hit the little speech bubble button on the top of your taskbar and start sending them in. We have the full team on deck who can answer your questions right now. So I'm going to jump into one. Lucas has sent us one, and obviously this is for you, Blair, because you've been the only one who's been talking. What is the long-term impact of the trend of high minimum temperatures, and is it being observed already? That's question number one. That's a deep one.
Yeah, okay. So what this is about was the temperatures I talked about were mean temperatures, which combines both daytime maximum and overnight minimum temperatures. Both daytime maximum and overnight minimum temperatures have been increasing. For much of a century, overnight minimum temperatures in Australia had been increasing faster than daytime maximum temperatures, but that's actually reversed over the last 20 years or so. So they're now both increasing at a fairly similar rate. But many of us perceive heat through high daytime temperatures, but high nighttime temperatures can also be very important, especially in applications such as human health. There's plenty of evidence when we look at the health impacts of heat waves, but it's the a lot of the real damage is done through the lack of overnight cooling and the lack of opportunities for recovery. Those increasing overnight temperatures have also led to decreases in frost frequency in some areas, particularly Queensland. In southern Australia, as I mentioned earlier, because the climate has been getting drier, so you have less cloud during winter and less soil moisture. And with that offsetting the overall warming trend, frequency of frosts in the southeast inland and southwest inland has actually levelled off since the 1980s.
Okay, excellent answer. We've got another one for you, Blair, from Jake. What type of weather patterns have we seen emerging recently, and are they different to predicted patterns of climate change? So in brackets, have we had to change our models based on what we're seeing?
Yeah, look, one of the main things we have seen over recent decades, and this is consistent with what climate models told us we would expect with increased greenhouse gases, is we have seen a strengthening of what's called the subtropical ridge, which is the belt of high pressure, which covers southern Australia. In the winter, it tends to be the subtropical latitudes. In summer, it moves further south to be in more southern coastal and Tasmanian latitudes. And that strengthening of the subtropical ridge has been one of the major drivers for decreases that we've seen in cool season rainfall. So, in that sense, even though the amount of rainfall change has been at the stronger end of climate projections, the way it's been playing out is not particularly surprising.
Oh, sorry, I've been on mute that whole time. Excuse me. I was just saying, John has sent us in a question, and it's not the John from the that you'll hear in a minute. We have a question from him saying, is the movement of atmospheric pressure systems away from the equator due to global warming, and how will this movement affect weather patterns?
Sorry, yeah, about that. Well, that's essentially what I was talking about in the previous question. So, we have certainly seen a strengthening of subtropical ridge, probably more a strengthening of it as a whole, a bit more so than a southern movement, but the effect of that on southern Australia is much the same, and that's that has been a major driver for the observed rainfall decreases in the cool season in southern Australia.
Okay, thank you for that, Blair. I do want to mention we do have some people answering questions in the background, so if you don't get it asked, you could also get the chat answered to. So keep sending them in. We'd love to answer as many questions as we can. I think this might be the last question before we move on to the next section. Shahan, which I apologize if I've got your name wrong, has said, what is the impact to the number and frequency of cyclones in Australia based on climate change? I know you did touch on this before, but if you go into a little bit more detail, that'd be fantastic.
So we've what we observe in Australia is we do observe a decrease in the number. For Australia, because we're dealing with a relatively small sample, we don't really see a convincing trend one way or the other in the occurrence of extreme cyclones. But when you broaden it out to the whole world, there is a clearer trend towards cyclones becoming more intense. The other interesting thing with tropical cyclones, and actually probably the most clear-cut climate change signal with cyclones, is that a cyclone of a given intensity is capable of producing more rain now than it previously would have been. And that ties back into the idea that warmer air is capable of holding more moisture. We haven't got particularly tight connections for that in Australia yet, partly again because of a relatively small number of cyclones, so we're still collecting evidence. But we have seen examples overseas of tropical cyclones which have had colossal amounts of rainfall, and one which some of you will probably remember was Hurricane Harvey in the US in 2017, which dumped over 1,000 millimetres of rain in the area around Houston in Texas and caused catastrophic flooding there. And there have been studies done of Hurricane Harvey which show quite clearly that climate change has had some influence on that extremely high rainfall, and we would expect that to emerge over time in more parts of the world, including Australia.
Okay. You seem to just be able to pull these facts so quickly out of the back of your mind, like I pull Simpsons quotes. It's incredible, Blair. Thank you so much. And if you want to test Blair's knowledge, there's always the chat function that you can throw something into, and we'll try and get it to him. We are going to have a final Q&A session in just a little bit, but we do want to continue with the presentation. That doesn't mean that your questions aren't getting answered in the background. We're going to try and do as many of those as possible. Right now, John from the CSIRO is going to talk to us about changes in the oceans and seas. So it's all yours, John.
Thanks, Jordan. Don't feel too bad. I don't think anybody has the sort of encyclopedic memory that Blair has, including myself. So thanks, everybody. It's great to be here. I'm coming to you today from Bunurong country in the southern suburbs of Melbourne. And I'm going to touch on the oceans and atmosphere aspects of the report, so sea surface temperature, some of the marine information, what's going on with greenhouse gases, and as well as that, I'll close out with touching out a bit of a snapshot of what the future looks like going forward. So let's jump into the sea surface temperature. So as Blair touched on earlier, the sea surface temperatures, when they're averaged globally, have increased by 1.05 degrees since 1900. But you can see on the map on the right there that it's a very unevenly distributed temperature change. The East Australia Current is intensifying, which is bringing warmer waters from the north and extending them further south, which at least in part explains that higher increase in temperature over that area abutting the southeast of Australia and Tasmania. So that's where we've seen the greatest increase in temperature, but there's another hotspot off the northwest coast as well. And this warming, of course, just as the warming of the air contributes to heat waves that we experience on land, the same thing happens in the oceans. So as the ocean gets warmer, then we're seeing more and longer marine heat waves. And these heat waves, of course, impact some of the marine systems, particularly fish hatcheries and reef systems, both the Great Barrier Reef and the reefs elsewhere around Australia, including the northwest. Apologies, I think I said the 1.05 degrees Celsius increase was global. It's not, that's around Australia, that's the Australian, which is increased by that. And the other thing to say about sea surface temperature is that 8 of the 10 warmest years on record have occurred since 2010. So in the last 12 years, we've had 8 of the 10 warmest years on record in terms of sea surface temperature. Next slide, please. So, of course, it's not just the surface of the oceans that warm. Oceans are deep places, and very deep in some places. And they're very important in terms of controlling or influencing the global climate, because so much of the extra energy that is added to the climate system by the enhanced greenhouse effect is taken up by the oceans. Greater than 90% of that extra energy is stored in the oceans. And that's amazing. It's both a good thing and a bad thing. It means that the warming on land hasn't been as severe as it would otherwise have been, but of course it has negative impacts on marine systems. The graph on the right shows the average ocean heat content in joules, a measure of energy, and that's averaged over the entire depth of the ocean. And you can see that it's a very steady trend upwards over time in terms of the amount of energy that's been gained by the full depth of the ocean. Next slide, please. When water heats up, as we all know, it takes up more space, it expands. And that, of course, means that because our oceans, that basically means that the oceans get higher up. So an expansion of the oceans leads to sea level rise. And globally, we've seen global mean sea level rise by around 25 centimetres since 1880. But importantly, as an indicator of how that's accelerating, half of that rise has occurred since 1970. So quite a pronounced acceleration in the rate of sea level rise. It's up around 3 millimetres per decade at the moment. The plot that you can see on the right shows in the shaded areas over the ocean, it shows the change in sea level in millimetres per year as indicated by measurements from satellite altimetry. And you can see that just like the temperature plot earlier, it's an unevenly distributed situation. So the southeast coastal areas there experiencing the greatest rates of sea level rise, as is the Gulf of Carpentaria up north. The dots that you can see superimposed over the line that shows the coastline of Australia show the results from calibrated tide gauges. And you can see that sometimes the dots show a slightly different story than the deep ocean changes that are shown further out. You can also notice that there's a gap between the boundary of the country, the coastline, and where the satellite altimetry data are shown. That's because once you get close to the continent, you start to get effects from the land surface that's actually underwater. So that near shore bathymetry makes a difference. And so it's the results that are shown on this map are just the deep water changes. And the tide gauge data shows what's going on right at the coast. And the reasons why sometimes there's a different signal between the tide gauge and what the satellites show further out is complicated, but there's a range of reasons for it. But they include things like the land might be rising or sinking, and that, of course, will appear as a change in sea level when really all that's happening is that the land height is changing. Obviously, that still means if the land height is going down, you're still going to get inundation. So the impact is still the same, but the causes are different. So it's a complicated story, but it's important to understand that what you may be experiencing at the coast may not necessarily be reflected by what's happening further out at sea. Next slide, please. Now turning our attention to the greenhouse gases, which are fundamentally the driving force behind all of the changes that we've talked about. This slide focuses on three of the most important greenhouse gases: carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide. Now the carbon dioxide annual mean concentration in 2021 was 414.4 parts per million. That's a 50% increase from the concentration of 277 parts per million in 1750. So we're seeing the highest concentrations of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere now than have occurred for at least 2 million years. On this slide, though, I wanted to highlight two things. The rate of increase of methane and nitrous oxide concentrations in the atmosphere over the last 2 years are the highest since we started monitoring three decades ago. So all of the greenhouse gas concentrations are rising, and methane and nitrous oxide are no exception. Methane and nitrous oxide are important because whilst they don't contribute to as much of the total global warming as carbon dioxide does, they are both very, very potent greenhouse gases. Methane, for example, is, you know, has the potential to warm the climate 83 times greater than carbon dioxide has. Big difference, though, is that methane doesn't last as long in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide, once it's in the atmosphere, stays there for decades, 100 years or thereabouts. But methane only stays for the order of a decade. This means that it's an opportunity for us. If we could find ways to rapidly reduce our methane emissions, then we could make quite a substantial difference to the overall greenhouse gas concentrations and the warming that they exert on the climate system, whilst we get, you know, make the more difficult changes to our systems that will be required for minimal carbon dioxide. Methane is occurs naturally, so it's emitted naturally by decomposition in wetlands, but it's also produced by human activities, and obviously those are the areas where we could focus on. Nitrous oxide is a little more intractable. It's even greater warming potential than methane, but its main source, or a major source, is fertilizers, nitrogenous fertilizers that are applied to the land for agriculture. And of course, we've got to feed a growing population, so it's going to be much more difficult to get on top of nitrous oxide. And next slide, please. This slide shows the carbon budget. So that's, you know, the debit and credit sheet, if you like, of carbon. In particular, the focus on carbon is because it is the major source of greenhouse warming, as I've mentioned. So in this report, it shows the same as previous reports that the global emissions of carbon dioxide from fossil fuel sources and from land use change continued to increase in recent decades. And you can tell by examining the details of the chemistry of the carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, whether it came from fossil fuels or whether it came from other sources. So this is very robust information. So fossil fuel burning is the main source of carbon dioxide. In the decade 2011 to 2020, about 90% of global CO2 emissions were from fossil fuels and about 10% from land use change. But you can see in the plot on the right, the coloured sections that are below the line, below that zero line, that represents carbon dioxide that's taken up by various so-called sinks. So the ocean absorbs carbon dioxide. That's what drives some of the chemical changes in the ocean, like that have led to acidification. The land takes up carbon dioxide. Most people will remember from high school that plants take up carbon dioxide. So the land is responsible for taking up quite a bit, and then the atmosphere as well. So you need to take into account what's taken up with what's emitted before you can reach a net understanding of the net change. And so despite the uptake by those natural sinks, carbon dioxide has continued to accumulate in the atmosphere at 18.6 gigatons per year over that decade, 2011 to 2020. And importantly, even when the world all but came to a stop because of the global lockdowns as a consequence of the COVID pandemic, and that led to a dramatic reduction in the emissions of greenhouse gases, the biggest reduction since the Second World War. Yet that didn't stop the amount of carbon dioxide that's actually up in the atmosphere. It didn't stop that increasing. That concentration of carbon dioxide continued to increase right through that period. And emissions have unfortunately now reverted back to essentially where they were pre the pandemic. However, it has demonstrated that we can reduce our emissions by the amounts that are necessary to slow global warming. It's just a matter of finding solutions that don't mean we have to basically stop living our lives. Next slide, please. So now just turning our attention to the future climate, and those who've been watching the State of the Climate reports for the last eight editions, this is the eighth, this is the seventh, we'll see some, you know, continuing messages here. We are continuing to see those same sorts of changes as have been reported before. And most of those are expected to continue into the future. What's included in the report is a bit of a look into the near future, really, the next 20 years or so. Beyond that, what happens with the climate, both globally and nationally and regionally, will really depend on what the global community does in terms of greenhouse gas emissions. Higher emissions lead to greater concentrations in the atmosphere, and that will lead to larger impacts, while less warming and fewer impacts will result if we can rein in those emissions and bring the concentrations down. So it won't be a surprise to anybody that the projections indicate that nationally and globally, temperatures are going to continue to rise. And as Blair spoke about earlier, that's both the minimum temperatures, the overnight temperatures, as well as the maximum temperatures. For the same reasons, because the ocean is expected to continue to warm, then sea level rise will continue. Marine heat waves will continue to increase in frequency and intensity. And we're likely to have more heat waves with fewer cool days, and the consequent health impacts that Blair spoke about earlier. Those heat waves are likely to continue to become longer and be more intense. Blair spoke about the trends in tropical cyclones, and the projections are consistent with those trends. All of the modelling and analysis of multiple lines of evidence indicates that we should expect there to be fewer tropical cyclones, but the projections show that when those cyclones do occur, they're more likely to be in those higher intensities, the Category 4, Category 5 storms, and with associated increased rainfall. The information about rainfall change with tropical cyclones is a rapidly evolving area of research, and recent results are showing that we can expect increased rainfall as a consequence of those higher intensity storms. That's intuitive, but now we have the data to demonstrate that that's expected to be the case. Speaking of rainfall, we do expect the trends that Blair described to continue. So cool season rainfall is expected to decline in the south and east. That's a very robust projection. Heavy rainfall is expected to continue to intensify. And again, that's a very robust projection. And somewhat counterintuitively, heavy rainfall events are expected to intensify even in those parts of Australia where the average rainfall totals are expected to decline. And as Blair said, we have observed that already. That's happening, and it's going to continue to happen into the future. Some more recent work that's only just come out is showing that in terms of heavy rainfall, those really high short-term intensity events are expected to increase at much greater rates than we previously thought. And in terms of fire seasons, More of the same, really, expecting those seasons to become longer and with yet more of the dangerous fire weather to be prevalent. Those fire seasons are expected to continue to kick in earlier and last longer. And we also expect there to be more large fires as a consequence of that. And I think that's my last slide.
It is. Thank you very much, John. That was super interesting. If you have any questions, like I've been saying before, now is the time, because that's given you a lot of information on the State of the Climate Report 2022. It's a super detailed report, which means we have heaps of questions already, but I'd like to invite all of our presenters to join us again so we can take on these questions and get through as many as possible. We do have people answering them in the chat, and we do have the live question and answer as well. This is the last opportunity to ask anything of all our panelists. So let's get to some of those questions that have been sent in. First, we are going to hear from Diane, who's asked John a question. Do we have regional predictions in Australia for how the climate will evolve over the next 20 to 30 years?
Right, that's a really good question. The short answer is yes. We haven't talked at all about how we do climate change projections, but one of the most important tools are climate models that are run on supercomputers. And we can draw on global modelling that's undertaken by the international research community, and there are a large number of climate models that we draw on to do that. In addition to that, it's possible to do what's called dynamical downscaling, where you use a computer climate model, computerized climate model, just like those global models, but you take the information from the global model and then you run it at a finer resolution over a smaller area. And that type of work has been done for parts of Australia. There's been a very concerted downscaling projections effort in New South Wales, in Queensland, and in Victoria. There's also been some work at higher resolution done for South Australia. And there's more to come. So there's recently a big move towards a much more coordinated approach across the country that will also dovetail in with the international efforts in a seamless way. So watch this space. There's more to come. But yes, those sorts of projections have been done, and there's a lot of information available online from those projections efforts. But you also asked about the next 20 years, and that's a little more difficult because you'll hear us talk about the uncertainties in climate change projections all the time. And it's an unfortunate fact that in the near term, say over the next 10 years, the uncertainties that are brought about by the natural variability that occurs year to year and decade to decade, the types of things that we all experience, you know, in our lives, that natural variability is going to continue, but it's going to continue against the background of the long-term change trends. However, that means that in the short term, over the next 10 to 20 years, that natural variability, particularly with highly variable aspects of our climate like rainfall, are going to be far more influential than what's happening with the underlying trend. And you don't really see the trend sort of emerging from that year-to-year noise, if you like, until you get about 20 years out. So over the next 10 to 20 years, it's more difficult. We can do projections about the way in which the odds of, you know, wet years, dry years, those types of things might change. But to get to the really quantifiable stuff, then we're sort of talking beyond 2030, really, in the climate projections.
Okay, excellent. Very, very detailed. And I know I do sometimes struggle with quantitative and qualitative. I've got school flashbacks then. We're going to stick with you, John. Matthew has sent a message saying, do you expect to see continued and heightened volatility generally in weather events and resultantly greater impacts on infrastructure and dwellings?
Certainly the projections show that we should expect the types of events that cause, you know, big insured losses and things like that, you know, those types of events are becoming more intense and more frequent. and are expected to continue to do so into the future. So, you know, yes, we expect that, but it's also here right now. So, you know, we've seen, Blair spoke about this, we've seen massive impacts from extreme climate events already. And so, you know, it's here and now. It's a mistake to think this is a problem for the future. We're grappling with it right now. I'm not entirely sure I answered that question fully. Feel free to jump in if you think I didn't.
If there is a question that somebody has, or if they want a more substantial answer than we can give right now, you can always send an email to weatherquestions@bom.gov.au and we will do our best to answer them. I'm going to move on. We've got a question from Bruce, who's asked, how accurately have climate change impact models predicted annual climate behaviours over the past 10 years? Can we place a rough figure on that? I don't know if you'll be able to do that. And is that figure increasing, or are we seeing our capacity to accurately predict climate change improving over time?
Okay. So just to speak to that last point, yes, our ability to project the future climate is improving, but it's a slow process. You know, it's a whole range of factors that influence the uncertainties in climate projections, and some of those are we'll never get away from. You know, there are some sources of variation in the climate, that some of which are just naturally occurring and are unpredictable. But also climate models, you know, by their very nature, any type of model is an imperfect representation of the real thing. And that's also the case with climate models. So they have their limitations for sure. One of the really important things to remember is that climate projections are about exploring what if scenarios. It's about what if the world does this with greenhouse gas emissions over the course of the next few decades, how might the climate respond? That type of thing. It's not possible for climate projections to give year-to-year predictions. So we can't, for example, say, 2070 is going to be a really strong El Nino. You know, that's just not a possible thing, and it will never be possible. But what we can say is that the average climate around the 2070s is expected to be characterized like this, and it might be. We might expect, you know, El Niños to be more common than La Niñas, or vice versa, something like that, but we aren't in the business of trying to predict what an individual year will be like. However, I think the root of the question is partly about, you know, how good a job have projections been doing in the past? And when we look at that, when we look at temperature and we look at the projections that that we produced back in the early 90s, and we look at what those projections were, and then we compare those projections with the way the climate has actually tracked since then, over that period, then we see that for temperature, the climate projections have done a pretty good job. If anything, we've tended to underestimate the amount of warming. But the data that Blair is largely responsible for track sort of within the band of that projection range that were done back in the early 90s. With rainfall is inherently much more difficult to simulate in a climate model. And when we look at those results, it's not quite as good. There are some parts of Australia where the projections were reasonable, still an underestimation of how much drying we would experience, but the real world has tracked within that range, albeit at the lower end. But there's a couple of regions in Australia where the climate modelling underestimated significantly that amount of drying, and the climate has dried at a faster rate than those climate models projected. So if anything, they've been too conservative. Certainly can't be accused of overstating the facts when it comes to climate model projections.
Okay. So we are kind of running out of time. We might extend the webinar just a little bit. I do know that people have work to get back to, or maybe holidays if you're lucky. If you are on holidays, what are you doing here? But we do have one question that I think would be good to kind of ask to the two of you. we'll start obviously with you, John, because you've got your mic on. Andrew has asked, what do you see as the most significant climate threat to Australia in the coming decades? And I thought it'd be good to get two perspectives on that.
Great. Yeah, that's a really good question. And it is a question that a lot of people ask us. Unfortunately, I'm not going to give you a simple answer, but if you're used to listening to climate scientists, you'll expect that. It really depends on who you are or what it is you're thinking about in terms of threat, most significant threat. For example, if you're running a hospital and you're really interested in being able to anticipate what type of demand you might have on your hospital system in the coming decades, then you may regard heat waves as the biggest single threat. You know, heat waves kill more people than big disasters like bushfires. So there were many more deaths from the heat wave that preceded the Black Summer bushfires of 2019, 2020, for example. So that might be regarded as the most significant threat if you're, funding hospitals, for example. But then if you're a wheat farmer, you may regard the most significant threat as change in rainfall. So it really does depend on what it is that you're interested in. So the short answer is this, from my perspective at least, there's no single greatest threat. It really does depend on what perspective you're coming at it from. Over to you, Blair.
Yeah, but I think my broad thoughts are pretty similar to John's. It depends a lot on what, where you are and, what your specific interests and vulnerabilities are. Looking at Australia as a whole, a lot of Australia, the availability of water is a limiting factor on, what can be done and what can't be done. And, in that sense, Australia is perhaps more vulnerable than a lot of places are to anything that changes water availability, whether that's decreases in rainfall during productive seasons for runoff or increases in temperature driving increased evaporation and lower soil moisture. I think compared to a lot of countries, Australia has real vulnerabilities in that space.
All right. Thank you very much for that answer. I thought they were both really interesting, especially to see, you're both part of two different organizations, and to see which one, what's important to either both of you is really interesting. That does look like all the time we have for questions today. There's a lot of information to take in earlier. So if you missed it, Blair is going to give a very quick summary of what we spoke about today and where you can find more information.
Yep. So, I think it's quite clear from what we've presented that there's a very wide range of changes in the climate that have occurred and likely to continue to occur. The report provides information on those changes and also provides information on planning for climate change into the future in conjunction with many other reports and assessments that have been carried out over time. And just here's a range of locations for further information. I believe the slides are going to be sent out to registered attendees, so you'll be able to access those links from here. There's a lot of information out there, and as was mentioned earlier in the presentation, we've also got the weather questions at bom.gov.au email address for any further questions. So thanks a lot for your time, and we'll see you all later.
Thank you, Blair. You really have kind of summed it all up nicely. There is a survey link in the chat. Please click it and tell us what you thought about today. As you mentioned, weatherquestions@bom.gov.au, and we will be sending around an email with all of this, the presentation and the video. The presentation materials and the video. A big thank you to John and Blair for your time in developing your content and for sharing your knowledge with us, and to Sharon, Katrina and Lynette for monitoring the chat, and Andrew as well. Thank you so much all for your time. We really appreciate you coming and joining us today. The chat, you might get a response in the chat, even though the the event will be down, but we just wanted to make sure that, you know, might get a reply a little bit later if Andrew or Lynette have a brainwave and want to answer one of your questions. Thanks very much. We really appreciate your time. Good night. Goodbye.